even know what benefits they could receive. I've worked with literally hundreds of vets to get their proper benefits so that they know what they can receive. So let me go back to the chronic homeless for a second. So out of 6,400 people, I'll get that one in a minute. The lack of recidivism, 94% of those people are still in the unit that we put them in. That is an amazing success story. So what happened was we had all of these buildings in the pipeline. We used 8 or 9 of them. Some of them have 300 units, some have 400 units. Really wonderful programs, mass releases, and we moved the chronically homeless in. Or we moved them, if they couldn't get on their feet, then we would have triage and have to go the mental illness hospitalization, and then into some kind of temporary permanent that led to permanent supportive housing. The key to a successful homeless plan, the key are the three words, permanent supportive housing. You can't put someone in a program for 6 months, have them get better, have them feel better about themselves, have them want to work, have them have some dignity, have them feel good about their time, whether it's in Iraq or Vietnam, have them feel like they're accomplished. You can't do that for 6 months and then put them back in the situation they came from. And that's what we were doing year after year after year. Permanent supportive housing, the chronic plan, would not do that. It put people right into units with a minute clinic on the bottom floor, which means there would be doctors downstairs. The perfect example of this is the YMCA on Golden Gate. The whole first floor had pro bono doctors from UCSF. And I see there are a couple of you here in the audience that helped us with this program. So I'm sure you remember how fantastic it was for someone who finally got into a unit to have medical care. So I could go on about this, and I don't have a lot of time, because I want to talk for a second about dirty streets and mental illness and substance abuse. But please look at the 10-year plan to end chronic homelessness. My goal today is to take people off the street within 72 hours, get them into some kind of, whether it's rehabilitation or whether it's a mental health issue, or whether indeed they can go right into housing. And that does exist. If you can get those that have been on the street not very long off, the sooner the better, you have much more of a probability of them staying off the streets. Right now, the largest group of homeless people, the new largest group of homeless people in the last year or two, are unaccompanied women. A large degree of them have been sexually violated at some point in their life, so they're hiding. And you can tell a mile away what their issues are and how to help them. So of course, the first thing to do would be to help them get off the streets as soon as possible. And that is my goal. Ladies and gentlemen, I am in this race because of the homeless situation. I'm in this race because of people living in tents, in disgrace, in a billion-dollar city, in an iconic city. I'm in this race to stop the horror of living on the streets, the horror of sitting down at the BART station and shooting up and slumping over while people who are going to their jobs just walk by. I'm stunned by this. And let me just mention a segue to this. Now, this is going to be a controversial topic, and I have never said this at a debate or at an endorsement. The amount of unconscionable money spent in this mayor's race, $4.8 million, could have housed so many vets that tonight will be sleeping on our streets. This system is very messed up, very messed up. It's unconscionable to me that that kind of money can be spent in a mayor's race with, you know, 10, 15, 20 flyers that cost $100,000 each while people are starving on our streets, while they're shooting up and basically killing themselves on our streets. So as mayor of San Francisco, my first job will be the chronically homeless. And obviously, an offshoot of that will be the newly homeless to help them get off the streets. And of course, help with the vet programs. I love the program that's in the Presidio. I love the program that's out in Treasure Island. Michael, I love that. I think those programs need to multiply. They work. It swords to plow no work. So, you know, when I see people like Michael, I see people like Ken, that are doing programs that are so wonderful, the program over near Lucas Films and the Presidio, it works. Let's fund that instead of wasting money. I could go on about mental health and other things, but I'll take the questions and try to...
So the next four questions were compiled by the Veterans Affairs Commission, city agency.
Absolutely.
And they are preceded by an informational prompt from the San Francisco Veterans Study that I mentioned before. So here's question number one. Over 40% of the post-9/11 veterans, the younger veterans in our community, and 20% of the pre-9/11 veterans, those mostly from the Vietnam era, have reported being homeless in the last year. On one hand, the San Francisco Department of Homelessness and Supportive Housing has reported significant difficulties in getting landlords to take the HUD-dash vouchers. Mm-hmm. They're kind of like the Section 8 vouchers. Yeah. On the other hand, many veterans have unstable living arrangements do not meet the Department of Housing and Urban Development definition of homelessness. And single-room occupancy, SRO housing, is not appropriate for older veterans who really need wraparound services. Right. So as mayor, what do you intend to do to make sure all veterans are appropriately housed in San Francisco?
You know, ladies and gentlemen, if I had to stop and pay attention to all the rules and regulations that I've put on qualifying people to give them housing, we would not have housed the people that we housed. What we did was we went out and we got the buildings. At the time, we had 18 buildings in the pipeline. We took master leases on them. And we put people literally from the street into rehab or from the street into mental health services with wraparound care and then into the unit that would have, as I said, the mini clinic in the area. The frustration of picking someone up who has served so many years of their life for us in a war where they put their life on the line. And then we go try to get them the HUD services, and one of the restrictions is something to do with, where they were born, or some of the restrictions of HUD were just impossible for us to deal with. So what we really did was get as much state and, we also got as much federal help as we could, but we went to the Veterans Affairs Secretary. We got to know him. In other words, it's a one-on-one relationship. It's pick the phone up and say, "Hi, Secretary Pinchy Bay, it's Angela in San Francisco. This is what is happening with this particular requirement. How do we overcome this requirement so that we can put Harry into the unit we have for him?" And I'm telling you, even on an individual basis, when you have a personal relationship with the people in Washington and the people in Sacramento, it changes everything. It changes everything. For the last 15 years of my life, when I see a homeless person on the street, I pick the phone up and I call Gavin. I say, "Gavin, this person is on Geary and Steiner. Please come pick them up." And then I wait until they're picked up and I follow their progress. Dealing with homelessness and dealing with HUD regulations and dealing with state regulations.